2:14, and he took the mantle of Elijah that fell from him and smote the waters and said, Where is the God of Elijah? And when he also had smitten the waters, they parted hither and thither, and Elisha went over. My thought for this service is activated religion. By this scripture, we are permitted to be on hand when Elisha, the protege of Elijah, became activated. Up until this time, he had been going along watching Elijah as he performed his duties. He followed as one going to school to another, and Elijah had inquired of Elisha, What do you desire of me? And Elisha had answered, I want a double portion of thy spirit. The condition of requirement given to Elisha was, If you see me when I go away, you may have it. With rigid determination, he kept his eyes on Elijah until that momentous day that Elijah was caught away as the chariot and the horses of fire appeared and a whirlwind took him into heaven. You can imagine Elijah standing with his eyes still focused on Elijah as he was going up. In great expectancy, he watched for the mantle of Elijah, and he was not disappointed. According to promise, old Elijah took off his mantle on his way up and dropped it down to Elisha. No doubt many memories of past victories filled his mind as he received that mantle. He wanted to try it and see if it worked for him, as he had seen it help Elijah. If it didn't continue as an instrument of power, it would be nothing more than a used, second-hand, hand-me-down cloak with very little value. So taking the mantle, he moved toward the Jordan River. It was no small thing he was about to undertake. To make the waters of the Jordan River go two ways with one stroke of a cloak was a mighty big thing to expect. He arrived at the scene of action and said, Where is the God of Elijah? He smote the waters and they did exactly as he commanded. They parted hither and thither. Then was the question answered. The God of Elijah was right there with the man who dared to believe as did Elijah and who expected the same works as Elijah. No longer was Elisha an observer or an onlooker, but he had now become activated. His efforts were rewarded, and his life became useful. As you have seen the account, to be activated is, as you have seen in this account, to be activated is to be made active. There is no special appreciation for anything slow motion, retarded, or dormant in its operation. Especially is this true in religion. For this reason, Jesus gave to the world a new and a living way. There was a time when religion was rather inactive. It consisted of ceremonies, priestly robes, offering of animals, burning of incense, hanging of blue, purple, scarlet, and fine twine linen wrought with needlework. This was carried on in connection with the tabernacle worship. The priest alone was permitted to go into the presence of God behind the veil of the tabernacle or temple. There is no question about the beauty of this impressive ceremonial worship, but the people stood without. They were not reached. If anyone was permitted to feel God's presence, it would only be the priest who annually went behind the veil into the holiest of holies. It did not accomplish the work that was needed among the people. God took away the first that he might establish the second. The people who were starving for a touch from God must be reached. They were dwelling only in the shadow of God's perfect plan, and they had a right to the better things that God had in store for them. The strange thing that presses itself upon us, however, is that even today, many desire to remain in the shadows with beautiful ceremonies and rituals rather than to accept the fact that God withdrew himself from that form when the new and living way was ushered in. John the Baptist, from all indication, was a very quiet and meek man by nature, but he was assigned a very honored place in God's plan. He was the forerunner of the Lord Jesus Christ. While the temple worship continued, incense burned, animals still died, John felt the urge to lift his voice in a proclamation that the Messiah was at hand. He became activated. His ministry was carried on chiefly as an outdoor work at the Jordan River. He spake only as he received word from the Lord. This was a voice of one crying in the wilderness, saying, Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. The city people heard of this unusual man at the river and went to see him. And when they saw him, he was, in every sense of the word, a shaggy prophet in his personal appearance. He was clothed with raiment of camel's hair. and a leathern girdle about his loins, and his meat was locust and wild honey. He was rough and unpolished and quite different in looks from the other ministers of his day. But, my friend, he had the message of the day. He preached in an unorthodox form and baptized those people who accepted his message. It was in one of these services that Jesus stood on the banks among the multitudes. John, seeing him, cried out, "Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world." And Jesus walked to the edge of the water to go in for baptism. And John said, "No, I have need to be baptized of thee," feeling his unworthiness. Jesus said, "Suffer it to be so, to fulfill all righteousness." And into the water Jesus went as John recognized his authority. No one could have a more honorable opportunity than was John's that day to baptize the Son of God. When Jesus came straightway up out of the water, it was a moment of great occurrences. God the Father spake from heaven and said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." And at that instant, the Holy Ghost descended upon him in the form of a dove. What an introduction to the world. The Father's voice was heard in tones of thunder, and Jesus was anointed with the Holy Ghost in such a way as to charge every fiber of his being. I believe it was at this moment that Jesus became activated and energized for his work on the earth. He left Jordan and journeyed into the wilderness and fought the devil. Coming out of the wilderness after 40 days, he met the devil and whipped him 3 more rounds, and angels ministered unto him. Then he went into the synagogue, and when the people were assembled, the minister handed Jesus the scripture to read. Turning to the book of Isaiah, he read, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, and to set at liberty them that are bruised." Jesus handed the book to the minister and sat down as all eyes were fastened upon him. And he said, "This day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears." Jesus' early ministry was begun, and a new and living way was inaugurated that would reach the people and take care of their needs. He met Mary Magdalene and cast 7 devils out of her, put mud in the blind man's eyes and said, "Go wash in the pool." And he came seeing. He straightened the crooked woman, made the sick man walk off with his bed. He caused the woman at the well of Samaria to run off and leave her water pot for the newfound joy she had just received. These people were reached by an activated religion. And when Jesus died, the veil of the temple was rent in twain, giving every man access to the holiest of holies and the privilege to appear at the throne of grace for himself. In his burial, Jesus demonstrated to all that the world has not the power to hold God's people down. When he, the captain of our salvation, came forth from the grave, he proved to the world that he is able to do anything. If he can rise from the grave, there is nothing he can't do. If the king's seal on the grave can be broken, there is no authority that can permanently bind God's people. If the Roman guards can be put down, all opposition can be subdued. If Jesus can bring some of the dead with him at his own resurrection, he can lift us from all circumstances. I'm glad to tell you that religion is not a dormant issue, too weak to lift itself, but that it is the most potent force in the world for good of the people. I think of the beginning of the church, like the creation of Adam. When God wanted action, he formed Adam out of the dust of the earth. He was first a mud man with eyes and ears and every part of his body formed, lying on the ground of which he was a part and from which he came. He wasn't doing anything. He wasn't going anywhere. He didn't know anything. He was just a mud man. He looked like a man, but was actually just the form. Then God breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and he became a living soul. He began to function, to breathe, his blood to circulate. Hands and feet could move, and I guess he must have sat up and looked around and announced that he was glad to be here. It took the breath of life to activate him. Likewise, the church had its mechanism arranged, its ministry called, its doctrine given by the Lord during his stay on the earth. And when he went back to the Father, he commanded them to tarry for power of God that should come.
So the church, being assembled at Jerusalem on the day of Pentecost, received the breath of life as a rushing, mighty wind and became activated, insomuch that 3,000 souls were added the first day, and daily thereafter. Their work was so great and powerful, their opposers said of them, "They that have turned the world upside down have come hither also." Religion is not supposed to be dead, but a resurrecting force. I think one of the most illustrative pictures in the scripture today of today's needs is when God showed Ezekiel the valley of dry bones. He asked him, "Can these bones be raised from the dead?" And Ezekiel answered, "Lord, thou knowest." And he was commanded to preach to the bones that were scattered all over the valley. And as he preached, they began to move and were joined together bone to bone. And there lay an army of skeletons. And even that, my friend, was progress. And he preached to them, "Behold, I will cause sinew and flesh to come upon you." And it came. There's a striking point here that I'd like to tell you about. The congregation is not likely to receive motivation until it's preached to them. They get what they are told about. There came the sinews, the flesh, and the skin. They had progressed into a whole body, but a dead body. No breath was there. So he prophesied unto the wind, and it blew upon them, and they took the first breath they had enjoyed in many years. They stood upon their feet, a mighty army. They had been activated from a valley of has-beens to a living militant force. God grant that there can be an activation of multitudes who have been reduced to spiritual skeletons and bring them to their feet as an army for the cause of righteousness. I praise God that across this nation, in many denominations, there is a cry for activation. There is a desire to leave the formal and to get the powerful. Many are receiving God's blessings as they move into the book of Acts and become spiritually activated. There is an outpouring of God's Spirit wherever men are truly worshiping God. Men are being saved and baptized in the Holy Spirit in this mighty move of God. Let me tell you, friend, it's not all over. It has not ceased. There need not be a spiritual slowdown. God is offering activation of the Spirit to all who will call upon Him. And I want to encourage you. You do not have to settle for less than the New Testament offers. It is available for the taking, and the promise is unto you and your children and those that are far off. Move up to the altar now and let us ask God to fan the flames of Pentecost in your heart until there is the conflagration.